Racism does exist. Denying its existence is harmful to society more generally, and people who find themselves the target of racism more specifically. With this in mind, it's important to understand all facets of racism. As such, we've created a two-part series inspecting the neural underpinnings of racism and how racism affects the brains of those who are often the targets of racism. So today, on Brief Brain Facts, we're discussing the psychological and neural characteristics of those who are racist or those who hold implicit racial biases. According to Dr. Claud Anderson, true racism exists only when one group holds a disproportionate share of wealth and power over another group, then uses resources to marginalize, exploit, exclude, and subordinate the weaker group. This definition is multifaceted and incorporates two agreed-upon aspects regarding race-based power dynamics. The first is explicit racism, or what social psychologists call blatant bias, where the intent is both obvious to the target and the individual holding these explicit racial beliefs. Blatant bias stresses belonging and controlling. Belonging focuses upon status and in-group identity, while controlling focuses on authority over who has access to resources and who gets to manage those resources. Explicit bias is best shown in the beliefs and actions held by members of the Ku Klux Klan, a well-known hate group and gang founded in the United States, known for playing a pivotal role in establishing racial segregation laws, terrorizing minority communities, and even killing African Americans. An often unknown aspect of race-based power dynamics is implicit racial bias. This bias type is what social psychologists identify as a form of subtle bias. It's automatic in that it's an uncontrolled and effortless response occurring without intention and awareness. It's ambiguous because responses are often open to interpretation. Finally, subtle bias is ambivalent. This captures the idea that in the United States, most whites hold both positive and negative feelings towards blacks, in that they will often blame blacks for their inability to overcome their relative disadvantage, while also believing that blacks do face continued discrimination, such as discriminatory laws. Due to the fact that these beliefs are often in conflict with one another, this aspect of subtle bias is unstable and adjusts depending on circumstances. According to researchers, this subtle or implicit bias is incredibly common, so much so that about 75% of both whites and Asians in the United States show a preference towards whites over blacks, and this favoritism can and often does have real-world consequences. As an example, in a recent study, medical residents were administered an implicit association test, which is a test designed to measure subtle racial bias. They were also provided medical history of white patients and black patients whose clinical details were indicative of a heart attack. Among white doctors, as their implicit bias increased, their likelihood of treating a black patient with a drug treatment in order to prevent heart attacks decreased. There are additional studies that do show real-world consequences of these types of bias within the medical field. Researchers stress that, like blatant racial bias, implicit racial bias is a learned behavior and has been attributed to certain areas of the brain responsible for learning, fear, and decision-making. In particular, the amygdala is largely responsible for conditioned or learned fear. This area of the brain has been shown to be active when presented with faces of other races, but remain relatively stable when presented with faces of one's own race. The amygdala is an emotionally reactive part of our brains. When we get exposed to negative and dangerous stereotypes, our amygdala is responsible for associating fear with racial stereotypes, thus creating a conditioned or learned response to people of a particular race. Unfortunately, culture is awash with these harmful stereotypes. However, we have a portion of the brain designed to, in many cases, save us from ourselves, including our own irrational fears. Our own knight in shining armor is the prefrontal cortex. If you've seen any of our previous videos, you probably saw this coming. Our prefrontal cortex is in constant battle with our impulsive and irrational limbic system, and part of this system includes none other than our amygdala. When the prefrontal cortex loses its fight against this system, behaviors such as impulsivity, aggressiveness, and irrational fear manifest. However, when the prefrontal cortex wins, it acts as our check and balance. When our check and balance system determines that a well-reasoned and rational response is needed, this part of our brain is designed to suppress the immediate and irrational reaction of the amygdala. Because this check and balance system isn't really fully developed until about the age of 25, the associations made between certain races and negative stereotypes have more than likely taken hold with little to no moderating influence unless you are fortunate enough to have regular and repeated exposure to people of other races, or, and very importantly, you had a guardian or mentor taking an active role disentangling these often false and dangerous racial associations. Other studies using patients with frontal lobe dysfunction have shown a relationship between the inability to control fears and regulate emotions and nationalist and racist views. But just because there may be some dysfunction in the brain doesn't mean these individuals have no responsibility for their actions and beliefs. In fact, the brain is pretty plastic, which means it's capable of being rewired, that is, forming new connections between existing brain cells. This is why people are capable of recovering lost functions, such as loss of language production, after sustaining an injury to the brain, such as a stroke. When exposed to new stimuli, new connections among brain cells create neural pathways that may help change one's old or problematic belief system. Cognitive exercises, such as meditation, can also be useful in helping train the prefrontal cortex gain control over the amygdala, thereby helping moderate automatic bad instincts. Regarding people exhibiting explicit racism, there's evidence to support that the use of psychedelic drugs such as psilocybin or lysergic acid diethylamide, aka LSD, could help promote a fundamental change in the brain that will enable people to be open to not only new experiences, but also new people. However, the use of these substances are not legal in the United States. So research surrounding these drugs are in the beginning stages, and their therapeutic benefits aren't entirely understood. As a society, we should always be doing better to establish more harmonious communities, and it begins by questioning and confronting stereotypes that help establish conditioned fear. For instance, believing that you are more likely to be harmed by someone of another race is not based in reality, but stereotypes. As data suggests, you are far more likely to be attacked by someone of your own racial background over someone from another race. Further, cognitive and pharmacological therapies may greatly benefit what was once believed to be unchangeable beliefs, especially now that researchers are better understanding what portions of the brain are involved in these particular biases. In our next video, we will explore the effects of racism from those on the receiving end, how it affects the brain, and what it means for their lives. What did you learn in this video that you didn't know before? Comment below. If you found this video informative, please share on your social media of choice. Like and subscribe to our channel for more informative videos on the brain and human behavior. And don't forget to go to our Patreon page where we conduct polls on what we should do in future videos, just like we did for this video. And as always, thank you for watching.